This is the first session of our second day of the seminar. As you can see from the wall, the title of this first lecture is How Class Works, Developing a Class Map for Post-Socialism. The lecturers are Dora Levačić and Mislav Žitko. Dora is a sociologist, member of organization for workers and workers' initiative and democratization from Zagreb. Mislav is a member of Center for Labor Studies and also teaches at the Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences. In their paper, they will try to provide some new methodological and conceptual tools for articulating the classic based on some recent scholarship. They will also try to apply these methodological and conceptual tools on the Croatian social structure. So please, and also just to remind you, please sign on the list of participants we need for the conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Marko. Yeah, we'll apply to, and soon as we get about 100,000 kunas for research. Okay. Thank you all for coming. Little disclaimer at the beginning. This is a presentation that we already had in Split a couple of weeks ago, so this is an extended version of the same presentation. The last quarter of century of post-socialist history has been marked by retreat from class analysis and its curious revival in the last few years. Even without going into specificities of forms and functions of class analysis in the period of socialist Yugoslavia, one can conclude that the rise of nationalist ideology and the consolidation of capitalist market institutions played a key role in the suppression of class analysis in the intellectual field. Thus, the absence of class in public and academic discourse is rather easy to explain, although there are approaches that take the retreat from class to be an outcome of ideology of classlessness or classless society promoted by the ruling party in the socialist period. These claims have been refuted elsewhere, and we will not discuss them here. What is interesting, however, in the context of the prolonged absence of class analysis, is the mode of its revival or its resurgence. It is interesting because it has been driven largely by mainstream sociology or mainstream academic sociology. The work produced by these groups of sociologists is both theoretical and empirical, and covers a variety of themes within class analysis. Still, most of it is grounded in the notion of different forms of capital, economic, cultural, and social, that should be analyzed together as they, this is the assumption, as they co-produce class position. In other words, the bulk of recent research on class can be incorporated under the label of cultural class analysis. So this is basically, these are the two sources of this revival of class analysis. And this is just a sample of recent papers, not all of them, which go under this label of academic sociology and which actually represent the material base for resurgence of class. As we shall argue here later, this is the precise part of the problem, since the cultural class analysis has been brought in under the pretense of escaping the narrow bound of economic determinism, and it in fact does not solve any of its main issues. It in fact breeds unnecessary confusion. So this is the academic. This is the part of academic sociology, which is, as I said, driven by the idea that economic determinism should be avoided at all costs, and that cultural class analysis is one of the main approaches to do this task. As for the so-called new left, the other source of the latest class resurgence, it has not managed to deliver conceptually sound and methodologically tractable class analysis. In the discourse of the New Left, the notion of class is usually invoked as a rhetorical marker rather than as an analytical tool. The latest volume edited by Horvat and Stix from 2015 is a case in point. The inquiry into the nature of industrial relations is closest it comes to analyzing social classes, as the questions of political identities and subjectivities, movements and rebellions shape its theoretical content. Thus, one can say that the revival of class theory in Croatia and in the region is somewhat ambivalent, as it is stranded between rhetorical invocation and analytical misappropriation. Before we return to these issues, it is necessary to do a brief overview of class theory, that is, to describe the most prevalent approaches to class and see whether they can serve as a foundation for a class map for post-socialism. For that purpose, we shall take a look first at Erickson-Goldthorpe-Portocarrero class scheme, and then secondly at cultural approach to class inspired by the work of Pierre Bourdieu. The Erickson-Goldthorpe-Portocarrero class scheme, the EGP class scheme, represents an employment aggregate approach to class, which means that class is defined in economic terms. The EGP scheme works in the way that it identifies three basic positions, those of employer, self-employed, and employee, and divides them according to the type of employment contract. The outcome is the class scheme based on 11 categories that capture the qualitative differences in employment relationships. The literature points to the strengths of the EGP scheme in the fact that it is relatively easy to operationalize, since one only has to have information on occupation coded to unit level group, employment status, and established size. So, not surprisingly, the UK office has adopted the EGP scheme for national statistics, and the national statistics socioeconomic categories are derived from this Erickson-Goldthorpe-Portocarrero scheme. From our perspective, however, the price of simplicity and validation in criterion terms is that one has to accept a nominal measure in which class is equated with employment status. Furthermore, the attempt by Goldthorpe and others to formulate a micro-sociological theory of class position has led to the development of a purely descriptive scheme, which by itself can only lead to a purely descriptive research program. This type of descriptive class theory offers no explanatory framework and leaves us with the tautological claim that class advantages are the product of class advantages. In contrast, the proper class analysis cannot be based on description and correlation alone. To be sure, discovering robust dependence between various phenomena is an important part of class theory, in as much as one wants to capture the regularities of class relationships, but it cannot act as a substitute for the proper form of causation that is at the core of explanatory mechanism. The explanatory mechanism gives reasons why some social indicators and some others are constitutive in determining the class position. In the case of class analysis of capitalist economies, these mechanisms tie together rules and institutions of the economic life and class position. In the Marxian class analysis, traditionally, the underlying explanatory mechanism was conceived in terms of theory of exploitation. In the recent debates on the theory of exploitation was dismissed because of the alleged inconsistency of Marxian labor theory of value. Social scientists, such as Sorensen, who understood that class theory is incomplete without accounting for underlying explanatory mechanism, tried to fill the void by developing rent theory of exploitation. In our view, Marxian theory of exploitation is not incoherent, but it is too narrow to capture all, all relevant sources of class inequality. The same goes for the EGP class scheme with its exclusive focus on employment relations. Before we turn to conceptual and methodological aspects of class analysis that would go beyond the employment aggregate approach, a few more words on the cultural class theory are in order.
Okay, tu je strelica.
Okay.
Okay. Given the circumstances of disqualification of Marxist theory in general and the portrayal of Marxian approach to social class as a limited and reductionist view of social reality, many researchers have turned to the cultural approach to social class, which is largely inspired by the work of Pierre Bourdieu. The main task of the cultural class analysis is to define the principles of social differentiation and the roles played by various forms of resources which are labeled as capitals. And those resources are usually divided into economic capital, social capital, and cultural capital, following Bourdieu. It is believed that all of these capitals taken together shape and define social classes. In this approach, classes are seen as multidimensional categories, as opposed to purely economic notion of class, which is characteristic for the Marxian class theory and the EGP scheme. So we are told by the followers of this approach that if we do not incorporate cultural practices and social networks in our determination of social class, our analysis will become just another gruesome variety of Marxian economic determinism. On the level of empirical research, this kind of analysis starts from collection of data about economic, cultural, and social capital. As indicators of economic capital, research participants are asked to give information about, for example, their income, property, savings, and so on. And as indicators of cultural capital, they are asked about their cultural preferences. For example, how many books do they own in their home? Whether they like going to theater or sport events, whether they like folk or rave or jazz music, and they're asked about their frequency of internet use, for example. As indicators of social capital, people are asked about their social networks, which means how many people and which people do they have contact with. So if you know a doctor, then you get, for example, 5 points on the social capital scale. And if you know one working class person, that's 1 point. This is, of course, an exaggerated oversimplification, but that's the logic behind it. When it comes to the analysis of the collected data, a method which is used most often in cultural class analysis, following Bourdieu, who used him himself, is a grouping technique called multiple correspondence analysis. So in general, statistical grouping techniques are used to group the data, obviously, or to simplify the data in order to discover the underlying regularities and patterns in the data, which are not visible by just looking at the data. So the basic idea, although this may look complicated, but the basic idea is very simple. It is to classify the data and organize them in groups or across some dimensions. So on this picture of a multiple correspondence analysis conducted by Mike Savage and his colleagues, the multiple correspondence analysis delivers a visual output which looks like this. And this output distributes the chosen indicators of class position, so measured by cultural, social, and economic capital. So this method distributes the data across several dimensions. The way this is done is that the closeness between the data, represented by those dots or little squares, represents the frequency of their combinations. So for example, if in our sample there are a lot of persons who have high earnings and who visit the theater often, then those two dots, which represent earnings and theater, they will become more close to each other every time a person who does both of these things appears in our sample. So that means that if there are a lot of people whose economic status and cultural consumption preferences coincide, then a very closely connected group of dots will arise. In other words, in the visual output, of course, in other words, there would be evidence pointing to existence of a clearly formed or a coherent social group characterized by high cultural capital and high economic capital. So the next step in this method is, of course, to interpret the results. The method does not do this for us by itself. So for example, we would observe a coherent group characterized by high cultural, economic, and social capital, and then we would decide to name it the elite. for example. So in a hypothetical scenario of a perfect correspondence between economic position and cultural preferences, for example, in the case of Croatia, we would find an upper class with, for example, high income and high value of property on the economic level, and the preference for national theater or playing golf on the level of cultural practices. The middle class, this imagined middle class, would, for example, consist of people with moderate income, with preference for organic food and listening to Sting. And the lower class would have poor economic resources and a preference for red meat and folk music. So the point of using this exaggerated example was to emphasize that this hypothetical scenario is, of course, highly unlikely to occur in reality. And here the problems for this kind of analysis begin. Contemporary research has shown that cultural consumption does vary to some extent with socioeconomic status, but of course not in a straightforward manner like in the example that I gave. That means that if cultural capital is included in the determination of class position at the outset, the class map will be distorted. An illustrative example of this problem can be found in the Great British Class Survey, conducted by a group of sociologists led by Mike Savage and financed by the BBC in 2013. So using a grouping technique, the team of researchers established the so-called seven-class model of the British society. The type of confusion generated by inclusion of cultural capital in the primary determination of class can be seen if we take a look at the lower part of the class distribution in the seven-class model. So these in the first column are the names of the seven groups that this analysis extracted, and on the lower end we have traditional working class and emergent service workers, and in the right column there is a description of the structure of those two classes. So the traditional working class has moderately poor economic capital, few social contacts and low cultural capital, while emergent service workers, another class, also has moderately poor economic capital, moderate social contacts, and the difference between emergent service workers and the traditional working class is found only in the cultural capital. Now, given that emergent cultural capital was measured by things such as going to pubs, playing video games, and listening to rap music, it is no surprise that the class of emergent service workers with the average age of 34 is a bit more engaged in these activities than the traditional working class with the average age of 66, which can be seen here. Obviously, what happened here is that cultural tastes and preferences came in the way of constructing social classes as categories of similar life chances. The resulting image is a misleading portrayal of the class structure of British society because it contains several analytical levels and treats them as having equal weight in defining the notion of class. In other words, it builds the effects of class into the definition of class itself. It is possible to look at the cultural class analysis as an approach that fails to make the crucial distinction between the notions of class and the notion of class reproduction, and also it fails to make a distinction, which is also crucial, between economic capital and its role in class formation and other forms of resources which are not economic. To be sure, cultural or social capital by themselves can be helpful in many ways. For example, if a person wants to make a good impression or find a job, but in order to have an impact on the class position of that person, cultural or social capital have to be converted to economic capital. On the other hand, economic resources or economic capital define our life chances and life conditions by themselves. For example, if a social contact helps us in finding a job, then our social capital is converted to economic capital, which directly influences and defines our life chances. If we have a lot of social contacts, but we are not successful in capitalizing them, that is, converting them into economic capital, then this particular social capital is not relevant for our class position. It may be relevant in many other ways, but not for our class position in that moment. as we see it. Or as a sociologist Colin Mills put it, we cannot use our social or cultural capital as a collateral for a bank loan. Valuable as cultural and capital are to us, they are not in themselves transferable to others, and we may or may not benefit from them. Unless they are physical objects like paintings, sculptures, or opera houses, then of course we can benefit from them right away. Furthermore, this is not to say that cultural resources do not play a role in the reproduction of class relations, or that social connections aren't important for class mobility, but only that they cannot be taken as constitutive elements of class position. The cultural class analysis obviously aims to identify the principles of social differentiation in cultural tastes and preferences, but the point we emphasize here is that the explanatory dimension of class analysis has gained very little from adding non-economic variables to the primary determination of class position. In other words, the descriptive expansion of the notion of class through the metaphor of capital does very little to improve the explanatory capacity of class analysis. Just as in the employment aggregate approach described earlier, the EGP scheme, the same tautology appears here. In the cultural class analysis, cultural resources are treated in the same way that occupational position is treated in the Ericsson Goldthorpe Porto Carrero scheme. So we know that being in a higher occupational position is the condition for a position of advantage. And the same is true for higher volume of cultural and social capital. Therefore, the framework provided by the cultural class theory remains a descriptive research program and offers no explanation about institutional and political origin of class inequality. In contrast to aggregate employment approach and cultural class theory, our approach is set to develop an explanatory mechanism for the causes of class inequalities, and it therefore cannot be reduced to occupational position nor expanded by provisional cultural categories.
In order to develop a class map appropriate for the understanding of social relations in the post-socialist period, one has to define a space of inequality composed of several indicators that correspond to key features of the economy. It is important to highlight several theoretical assumptions that will not be discussed here in detail, but are central to this theoretical enterprise that we are showing now. Firstly, unlike Koludrović, Tomić, Petrić, and Cvetićanin, we do not think that class exists or can persist outside institutional and economic relations specific to a mode of production. Thus, the connection between class structure in Yugoslavia and Croatia or Serbia or any other country in former Yugoslavia is virtually non-existent, and the attempt to draw a line between the two societies, as they try to do in their recent contributions, can only blur the important lines of a division. To put it simply, if one is to investigate socialism, then one has to develop a set of indicators pertinent to the socialist economy, and these will be completely different from those devised for the study of peripheral capitalism. Secondly, we understand capitalism as an economic regime in which monetary relations have a pivotal role. In other words, we subscribe to the monetary theory of production along the lines of Marx and Keynes. Money and other forms of liquidity are necessary for the purposes of accumulation and social reproduction. Since these monetary resources are unequally distributed in capitalist societies, there is a constant conflict over them, both within and outside employment relations. Once it is understood that money is not neutral, and that the metaphor of money as a veil distorts our understanding of how capitalism works, one can start to grasp the interrelation of money and class. In a nutshell, we argue that the various forms of monetary stocks and flows in aggregated form determine the economic capital of a particular individual or household. The class position of a particular individual or household is therefore an effect of accumulated economic capital in this sense. To reiterate, the constitution of class and the development of class map depends upon the economic capital alone, while in the course of class reproduction, other social and cultural resources known as social and cultural capital come into play. Once the sign of equality between economic relations and employment status is removed, it is possible to develop a framework for class analysis that will be reductionist and multidimensional at the same time. Thirdly, we take on board insights developed by the regulation school and varieties of capitalism literature. It is impossible to develop a class map without an appreciation for the spatial and temporal dimension of capitalist development. The fact of the matter is that there is no single model of capitalist development, although there are, as Wolfgang Streck explains, commonalities of capitalism. To put it very simply, some forms of monetary stocks and flows will be common to all capitalist societies, while others will be a distinct feature of a particular point in geographical space and historical time. Therefore, to develop a class map for post-socialism, one needs to identify relevant stocks and flows in a given society, and this is the table here represents the important institutions and the way they operate in the so-called dependent market economies, which are basically post-socialist economies of southeastern Europe. So,
I think it's the Visegrad countries, Norway.
What?
It's for Visegrad countries, Norway.
Yeah, but it is not only for Visegrad countries. It extends to also southeastern Europe. If you read the last pieces by Nolke and others, and we can also discuss it to what extent the various classification works. For the purposes of constructing class map for post-socialist society, in the concrete case of Croatia, and one can possibly add other countries of the region, we have chosen the six following indicators that saturate the space of inequality. This is labor income, income from capital and financial assets, income from non-financial assets, social transfers, savings, and debt. In the varieties of capitalism literature, Croatia has been situated in the group of the so-called dependent market economies. The distinctive features of these economies include deindustrialization, as I have shown on the previous slide, low rates of economic activity, and high rates of unemployment and financialization of household sector. Indicators of labor income, wages and salaries, and income from capital and financial assets can be regarded as constant features of capitalism given the pivotal role of wage labor, while, for example, income from non-financial assets and social transfers are included to capture the money flows of significant fractions of households that rely on income derived outside from the production process, for example, income from rental property to secure their material reproductions. To these monetary flows, debts and savings are added in order to account for the rest of liquidity in the system, basically. And they also have, in this present context, significant impact on the material standards of living and life chances in the context of capitalist development. So, unequal distribution of monetary stocks and flows represent the necessary starting point for developing a structural account of class inequality, that is, one that brings together causal explanation and statistical dependence in a single framework. Before we move on to some additional methodological considerations, let me just add a footnote on Marxian theory. Within this approach, a classical Marxian theme of exploitation of labor is a perfectly legitimate topic once the class map has been formed, because otherwise we don't know what we are talking about. The class map has not been developed and we have no idea how the class structure of a given society actually looks like. So to study, say, exploitation of labor relations altogether, that is perfectly possible, but it is dependent upon developing class map first, and then we can go on to see how other relations work. All right.
Okay, at the level of empirical analysis, our approach would consist of two steps. The first step, we can call it the pure approach, because its main task would be to identify social classes in Croatia following the indicators that were shown on the last, the previous slide. And then the data would be analyzed by a grouping technique similar to the one that was shown before, but this one is a bit different. It is called latent class analysis, conveniently. The basic logic behind this method is similar to the one mentioned earlier. So latent class analysis processes the data by estimating the number of latent classes which underlie our data. So this method can help us decide whether a two-class, a three-class, or perhaps a 10-class model is adequate for representing the space of economic inequality in Croatia, for example. And it also estimates the probabilities of class membership for every individual respondent. And it estimates the probabilities of particular responses. So that means, for example, this model would estimate, after we collect the data about those six indicators, the model would estimate that for perhaps the three-class model is the most adequate representation of Croatian class structure. And it would estimate that, for example, the respondent number one is 80% likely to be a member of the group one, and has an almost in full probability of having very low income and no property. And then it would do this for every respondent. So we would have this information for all of our respondents, which we do not have now because we only have income from labor or income from financial assets, and the data is very incomplete, so we cannot do this this type of analysis unless we have all of this information together in one questionnaire, so that it can be analyzed using this method. So on the basis of our indicators, the latent class analysis can give us an insight into the distribution of these indicators in society, which we cannot know in advance. We can know on the level of structural analysis what are the main sources of inequality generated by the economic system, but we cannot deduce an empirical description of real social classes from that structural level, which is a topic that Stipe actually talked about yesterday. Apart from answering the question about the number and structure of the latent classes, this technique, the latent class analysis, can give us an answer about the size of different classes. If there are 40% of our respondents in the first group, for example, then, of course, with the precondition of having a good sample for our research, we would claim that there is a large lower class or working class, as we choose to label it, in Croatia. So we gain an insight into the number of classes, their structure, and their sizes. This model of social class also allows to study trends in inequality. For example, we can ask the question, is inequality taking an increasingly class-like form or not? Or are some classes becoming well-formed, or are they breaking down? For example, we could answer the question, is the middle class breaking down? And the visual output of this analysis could take three ideal forms. So the first one is the three-class model, a model with three coherent classes. It would suggest that the various dimensions of inequality are coming together in ways that make the inequality space increasingly class-like. So the data group themselves in three coherent classes. Unlike that scenario, we could find that the gradational model is the most adequate representation of our data. That would mean that would look like this in the visual output, and that would mean that the occupational position, the scheme, actually Ericsson-Goldthorpe-Portocarrero scheme, which takes into account only the occupational position, is the most adequate one for representing inequality. In other words, that would mean that nothing is gained by adding other variables apart from occupational status, so that a class can be equated with occupational status. And the third possible scenario would be the ideal postmodern scenario, which would look like a disorganized form of inequality. So there is much inequality in this picture, but it is structureless. It does not form any coherent groups along any dimensions. That would mean that the growth of inequality doesn't imply a stronger association between income and overall inequality. Also, we can look at whether those classes correspond to, for example, occupational groups or any other variable or not. So the clear benefit of this method is that it is semi-inductive. We can, of course, have some hypotheses and assumptions and build them into our model and actually even test those hypotheses. But the important thing is that we do not begin deductively with expectations about the size and structure of concrete classes, but with the distribution of material advantages represented by the six indicators that we chose. And then we can look at what determines the class positions, which are thought of as combinations of those indicators. By including the variables outside the model itself, for example, so we can look at what determines the class positions by looking at the variables outside the model itself. Those variables could be, for example, gender. So we could observe that perhaps women are underrepresented in class 3, the elite, and overrepresented in the lower class. But we wouldn't have an assumption about that before we begin with analysis. This leads us to the second step of our approach, where class would be used as either a predictor or an outcome in an interaction with other variables. In other words, the interaction between class and various outcomes, such as political attitudes, for example, could be studied. Or, for example, we could study the interaction between social capital and economic capital. The benefit of doing this following our approach, instead of collapsing them together in the definition of class, the social and economic capital, so the benefit is that we don't assume that having more contacts automatically puts one in an advantage material position, but we can look at the interaction between social or cultural resources and material position. And then we can answer the question, how important is having high cultural capital in Croatia for our life chances, for example? Again, that would be done without assumptions that social capital is important for class position in a straightforward way. The same goes for occupational position. Of course, occupational position is important for life chances directly. That is something that we do know. But the advantage of the latent class model is that it gives a more accurate view of the importance of specific occupational positions for class position in general, which cannot be known in advance, considering, for example, the changing work conditions and rewards associated with certain occupations. So we cannot know in advance, for example, what is the class status of a high school teacher today, without knowing the other indicators of this teacher's class position. So to conclude, we argue that class analysis should start from the indicators of material disadvantage or advantage, which arise out of the sources of inequality generated by the economic system. In that way, the analysis is not purely descriptive or purely abstract or structural. Our approach begins by taking into account the material life conditions based on a set of monetary indicators which are necessary to define life chances. Instead of a deductive approach based on uncorroborated assumptions, we develop a class map grounded in empirical data and appropriate methodological procedures. Thank you.
Thank you, Dora and Mislav. And now, as usual, please, your comments, interventions, questions.
Well, I don't have a well-formulated question because several times during the presentation I had a question and then it was answered subsequently, which means that that's a good thing for the presentation. So I may be just restating the obvious or maybe asking you to just highlight two things. So one is the varieties of capitalism approach is then considered as a possible source of hypothesis, is that correct, for expectations of why a class structure would be different in Croatia vis-a-vis France or somewhere else, right? And if that's so, did you kind of go a little bit in the direction of forming these hypotheses? What would you expect? Maybe that would be one. And then the second, if you say, okay, we're only going to look at economic variables for the map, for putting the class map together, and then in the end, you said, okay, so the social capital, the cultural capital, and also maybe political predispositions and preferences would then be use to what to do that what. So then the economic is the predictor for these, or are you saying there is a kind of a dynamic, an interaction that we can just maybe explain this a little bit more? Thanks.
Yeah, we used here the varieties of capitalism, and I also mentioned the regulation school. The important thing is here is their basic common insight that there is not one single model of capitalist development, as I said. And then we can actually discuss the advantages of various approaches. We do not have to focus exclusively on one group of authors or one type of literature and so on and so forth, but we need to understand the dynamics of development of, say, core and periphery, because from that dynamics and from the differences that arise from these different dynamics, we draw conclusions about what indicators to take into our model for determining class position. So this is a background story, or it's a sort of backbone to this model set of indicators that we have chosen here. It is because this literature allows us to identify some structural features, not of capitalism in general, but of capitalist societies in particular, that we can connect them with this whole task of developing a class map appropriate for a given society.
I think we can even go, you know, one step further in terms of actually formulating hypotheses or expectations of the map, because if we know that these types of economies have structural unemployment which goes above 20%, or that social policy is very restrictive, yeah, that would then, you know, generate concrete hypotheses about
what. And we actually did that to some extent here can discuss among ourselves this concept of social transfer, which is extremely important in Croatia, especially because the latest edition of the World Bank report is out again, and you can see if you read it closely that the so-called generous welfare state is when it comes to social spending, spends a lot of money, a lot of financial resources on the war veterans and the related related groups. So, and this is now so stabilized that these would probably form a particular class subfraction in Croatia. And this is a peculiarity of our society, and it needs to be taken into account when we develop a model. We will find this problem in Serbia and in Russia comparatively, but other countries do not have a population of war veterans that is taking so much of social spending in terms of percentage of GDP.
And this translates into the damage of political conflict. So that's,
yeah. And so in the second step, and I think Dora will deal with this question maybe more extensively, but the main point here is this, that the first step is obviously to develop a class map, and in the second step, via regression analysis or other tools, we can see how chosen variables how they relate to one another, how they interplay, and that's the point Dora made between understanding what social class is and how this position is related to, say, political preferences or political activism or cultural consumption or whatever it is. So the point is that the analysis that creating a class map is the first step in the analysis, and maybe all of the interesting things come later on, but you have to know what you are actually talking about when you talk about class in a given society. And it, in our view, you cannot do this without actually making this first step in a coherent and precise manner. So,
okay, to answer the question about the relationship between economic capital and other forms of capital. So we can start with this multiple correspondence analysis, this map. So Bourdieu used this analysis because he was against the logic of regression in social science. He thought that everything is connected, that it is not a one-way direction between economic and cultural capital, for example. And then he made those maps. This map shows only indicators of cultural capital from the Savage's analysis. But we can imagine that indicators of social and economic capital together are put in this map. And then in the example that I gave, the ideal scenario where we would have three like very closely connected groups with coinciding cultural and economic capital. Now that's okay, so that's the analysis itself is not a problem because this map only shows us some the distribution of the data, and it can point to some associations between, for example, cultural and economic capital, but it doesn't say anything about the direction of this correlation or association. And Bourdieu was careful and he did not construct groups based on this kind of maps. He only interpreted the map. Actually, it is not so explicit in his distinction, but in his theory, he does put economic capital on a kind of primary level in interrelationship with cultural capital. So whether we use this kind of grouping technique or the one that we proposed, the latent class analysis, that is irrelevant. The relevant thing is, and the thing that we do not agree with, is that constructing social classes while looking at the cultural indicators of cultural capital like constituents of the class position. We may use regression models, so we may think of economic capital as the predictor of cultural capital, but we may also use the other way around, yes. We are not saying that economic capital determines our cultural taste, of course, we are actually saying the opposite. No, not the opposite, we are saying that is not true. Okay, so for example, or we don't have to use regression or any kind of statistical model, but once we have those groups, for example, four social classes, then we can look at their structure, which is what Savage did here. So, and his colleagues. So they looked at the structure, the sex structure, age, ethnic composition of all of the classes. And then we argued that we have to construct the social classes only by looking at the economic indicators. And then we can look at, for example, if we have an elite, like one group, then we can look at its structure according to sex, age, and even cultural resources or social resources.
Thank you both for a really, really interesting Sunday morning presentation. So I'm going to be the devil's advocate here for a Bourdieuian class analysis, and I'm going to try and argue this from a theoretical and from a methodological perspective. So in terms of the theoretical perspective, I totally agree with your criticism of Savage's work and some of the other authors who you mentioned who operationalize different types of capital and then present that as a class map. But for Bourdieu, to understand how class works, you need to look at field. So in his theory of practice, it's not just about possession or non-possession of capitals, it's the ways in which fields recognize them that creates class differences. So I think when you introduce field as a Bourdieuian concept, this could be the economic system. Bourdieu looked at the educational system, so it could be these different systems which actually produce class inequalities. So I'm just interested in what role Bourdieu's concept of field plays for you in your criticism of the framework. And the methodological point comes from me as a qualitative researcher, and that's that what I'm interested in then are these micro ways in which class is produced and reproduced. So I'm thinking, I'm listening to you, and I'm thinking, okay, if I'm doing a research project and you do this, you do before me a big research on sort of taking economic capital as a starting point. And I'm looking at what happens in education, how class is produced and reproduced through the educational system as a field. If I just stick to the economic aspect, can I really understand how class works in that field? So I'm just interested in the methodological potential of your class model that takes in those indicators that you mentioned, in applying that to how class works in different fields.
Okay. So, first of all, let me say that one of the problems with reading Bourdieu is that one has to realize that his analysis and distinction is an analysis of French society in a period where social relations have stabilized due to the rise of the welfare state and the position in France and Europe and so on and so forth. So this is a kind of very peculiar situation, and I would say in terms of history of capitalism, it is an exception. Yeah, that's so, and because we have stable economic relations in France at that time, we also have, by extension, the stability of cultural practices. It was the stability of economic relations that has allowed the middle class to develop certain cultural practices, the petty bourgeoisie to have their own ways of dealing with traumas of class society, as Bourdieu in detail explains in distinction and so on and so forth. So a lot of stuff that actually happens in the field of culture is dependent on the issue of economic accumulation. Is it stable? What kind of regime of accumulation we are talking about here? Is it financialized and so on and so forth? And we can see this by simple comparative study of two periods. Take Europe in that period between say 1945 and 1975, and then compare it to the economic regime that the financialist economic regime that grew out of it. All right, so that's one thing. So this is a very peculiar thing. And should not be kind of overextended or generalized, because it cannot be. That's the reason. With regard to the question of field, nobody denies here that there is a specific logic to a given field. Academic field has its own specific logic of reproduction. Cultural field has its own specific logic of reproduction. That's perfectly fine. It's perfectly legitimate object of study and so on and so forth. What we are saying here is that if you want to study class in a capitalist society, you have to take economy as the starting point, as the entry point. You have to make it intelligible in a way, design it so that it can actually be used both theoretically and methodologically in a given study. And then you can see how in the second step, when we talk about class reproduction as opposed to class constitution, we can see how these different social relations, cultural practices and economic activity, how they are correlated, how they are maybe integrated into a single class within a given time frame and so on and so forth. But that's like the second step of the analysis. The fact that we want to have this kind of economic reductionist approach to class does not challenge the notion of specific logic of social reproduction in a given field, because it's simply a completely different topic. And in fact, I think once that you would develop this map and go a step further and analyze general social relations, then you could, at that point, you could obviously use some qualitative techniques to kind of enrich the outcome that you already have from this type of study, and you can also maybe analyze a bit further the stability and the logic of reproduction in a given field. It's really it's really, these two things are not in collusion in any way. Yeah, they can operate side by side. Yeah, without any general problems. That is my view on this issue. Although we have not, as Dora pointed out, we have not developed a coherent critique of Bourdieu's own position. This is more this criticism of cultural class approach is more directed as this huge group of social researchers such as Savage that bring together all these different forms of capital, economic, social, cultural, political, and so on. And we have in our own backyard Koludrović, Tomić, Cvetićan in Serbia and others who are doing the same thing. This is the critique of this approach to analyzing social class, which we feel it's a dead end.
Yeah, but some of those. Okay, I will just give a short answer. Maybe Mislav said this, but to make it more clear. So we try to make a distinction between class position and class reproduction. And that would be the answer, because we think of class positions, of course, as results of many fields, social fields, educational fields, any important field for class position. But to define class, we have a very narrow, actually, definition of social class as something that has something to do with life chances in the cross section. So this is why we almost named our presentation Social Class, a Reductionist Approach. Because we think that the reductionist approach to the definition of class position is necessary to separate class position from class reproduction. And of course, if we would want to, we would definitely include indicators of cultural capital, educational attainment level, and so on in our research. Only we would not include those variables in the model which gives us the groups which point to the life chances at a given moment.
I have a maybe similar question, similar in the sense that it also touches upon the differences and maybe commonalities between more Bourdieu and Marxian approach, but on a more general level, it seems to me one of the main differences between these two approaches is not only a different weight given to economic as opposed to in conjunction with symbolic and cultural capital, but also the very manner of defining class, in a sense that at least it seems to me that Bourdieuian way of conceiving or defining class leans more in the way of classification. Let's say relations of difference, social differentiation or social division, which means something that pulls society apart or different, or sets different social groups apart, precisely in the sense of division of social space, both symbolic and very real, architectural, urban, and so on. These are classic Bourdieu themes. So social, basically, differentiation or division, which structures social space. On the other hand, Marxian definition or understanding in place goes precisely in a, or develops in a sense that pulls different groups of people together, but in an antagonistic way. So in a Marxian conception, class relation is something more like a relation of domination or subordination. So my question is, how does this Marxian, let's say, understanding squares with the conception of class like uneven distribution of life chances?
To nismo stavili na prezentaciju, Moderika. Okay, in conclusion of the book Class Counts by Eric Wainwright, edited by him, he named six different questions which can be answered by the concept of class. So I didn't remember all of them, but the first one was how are material conditions of life distributed. So that would be the question that we tried to answer, but also the the question of antagonistic interest and any kind of subjective class identity. But what he claims, and we agree with him, I think, both of us, that this doesn't... So if you try to answer the first question, the one that we try to answer, the classes that we come up with are not something... So if we want to... if you want the notion of class as a subjective identity and political attitude, we would still need to answer this question first. So, because we want to know which classes have like class consciousness or political consciousness or whatever, and in order to talk about that, we need to know what classes exist, which classes exist, and the only way we can do that, that would be empirically corroborated, would be by doing this kind of analysis that we proposed. And there is nothing that can stop anyone to talk about political attitudes and class, subjective class identities based on our approach.
I was talking about class relation, which is not necessarily subjectively felt or experienced, translated into any political attitude. I was talking about this antagonism, which puts you to work, basically, which is of course conditioned on the fact that in capitalist society you will be poor or hungry if you don't go to work. But I was talking about the relation of antagonism or subordination at the workplace, not in the strikes or in the protests or in political struggle. So basically, can you say that class exists? This is what bothers me. Can you say that class exists before class struggle, to put it very simply?
Okay, let's put it like this. So the notion of exploitation or antagonism is clearly an important notion for class analysis. It is important because without it, you end up with a descriptive research program. You simply describe what there is, what groups are there in society, and you can analyze them in one way or another, but you don't actually get the explanation of their behavior, as it were. Now, to add this dimension, one obviously has to take into account not just, you know, the description of class structure, but also how they are related to one another. And Eric Olin Wright, I skipped this part, but he also has made this type of classification, which is very similar to Goldthorpe and others, but it introduces, via game theory, the notion of exploitation back into class analysis. Now, the problem here with Wright's scheme, which is kind of a neo-Marxian class scheme, is that it remains exclusively focused on employment relations. So there are class inequalities, given the monetary nature of capitalist production, inside the factor, inside labor or employment relations, and also outside. And we can see this in debt crisis of households and in various other instances. So we need to develop a set of indicators that will take the entire field of this inequality, the entire space of these inequalities into account. This space has to be, once the indicators are developed, it has to be actually saturated, developed to the fullest. So the part that you are that you worry about, you know, the exploitations on the level of the exploitation on the level of relations of production, is there, and it is just one part of the whole space of inequality, class inequality in capitalism. So to develop the full map, we obviously take into account what is there on the level of production, but we also take monetary flows and stocks out that are not generated or are not directly related to the relations of production. And then, by extension, on the second step, we can see by the grouping technique presented here, we can see what classes, in what type or what number of classes there are in any given society. And on this very abstract level, yeah, of course, that there is antagonism between labor and capital, which is kind of structural, and there are also, you know, antagonisms in a financialized capitalism between the lenders and the debtors. But this is all very abstract. You need to have a way, a manner in which you will deliver this insight on a empirical level, and this is why we cannot stay on this abstract level, and we cannot also have an exclusive focus on employment relations. We need to go, like, so to speak, lower and wider.
Someone else? Okay, I have one question, methodological one, in terms of collecting data to apply all these methodological tools. In terms of what do you have, Mislav mentioned that the World Bank report, you can get some data. There are the data they can use, in sense, without just, you know, interviewing? There are some data in tax authority or statistics bureau, which kind of data are you? You can use at all, is not just being this interview with, I don't know, specific.
Right. There are basically two options. One is obviously to design a survey, and we already have the household budget survey, which kindly, which in a way corresponds to what we are looking for here. But the problem is that we look at this, and there is a lot of missing data because people are simply unwilling to answer the questions about their financial status and about their financial assets. And so that's the problem with the budget survey, and also with ISSP survey that is also available. It doesn't correspond to that extent to our requirements for the class analysis, but it is there, and again the same issue of missing data arises. This is kind of a peculiarity for Croatia. The other approach would be, the other option here is to collect data from tax offices and banks, which have obviously data on savings, debts, and incomes. But I think this is very unlikely scenario to have banks open their books, and even to have Croatian tax office to kind of share their data sets with us. It's not very likely. Piketty has tried to gather this data via, he actually wrote to, I don't know, Prime Minister and the head of Croatian tax office, and I don't think that Croatia will be part of Piketty's next book. So
further comments? Okay, we can now
finish, and thank you
once again for your presentation. Also, just one announcement, we will start the next lecture will be at 3:30 by Branko Benic from Slovenia, and also in the general discussion we will continue to discuss the questions raised also in this lecture. Thank you.